and there was a knot hole in the wood where if you lay down in the hay, you could see the comings and goings inside this house. So the police believed that the killer possibly lay down in the barn, staked out the house. The family were at a church event in the day. They came back that evening, went to bed, and then he came in and killed them all. Other detectives and historians think that he hid in the attic. And nobody is entirely sure. Let's go inside the house for a moment. Now, as soon as you walk in, you can see the Moore family. And it really, I've got to tell you, when you go spend a night or two in this house, it really hits home when you think that these people died in this home. It's a very visceral, very emotional experience for you to see their faces and know what happened. And their four children, absolutely tragic. So a family of six and then two visiting girls, 11 years old was the oldest. Very, very sad indeed. Now, this guy does look a bit axey, doesn't he? To be fair.
Devil, yeah.
Yeah, but this is one of many suspects. Probably the best, I think, personally, theory as to who did this wasn't this man at all, wasn't anybody local. There is a book which I'm sure they have in the library or they could order for you called The Man from the Train. And this posits the theory that a psychopath was riding the rails, a hobo essentially, across the United States, killing families as he went. Because there were a series of murders that all looked a lot like what happened at Villisca. One fairly close to us, down in Colorado Springs, where two families, neighbors, were killed. Same time of night, round about midnight. The house was always locked up tight. The family was sleeping. The killer broke in, usually through a window, or took off a screen, used the family's own axe from their woodpile. When you went inside their house, there were some things that were very, very odd. The killer always covered every mirror and reflective surface inside the house. Now, the drapes, the shades, were always down or drawn. That makes sense. You don't want people seeing in. But why cover the mirrors? Because he didn't want to see himself doing what he was doing. Everybody in the house was left. The bodies were left undisturbed except for one of the older females. And I say older females, we're talking about younger ladies. And there is, without being too indelicate, there is strong suggestion that at least one was assaulted either immediately before or immediately after her death. But all of the adults in the house who might fight back were killed. Usually with the flat head of the axe, not the blade. So we think of axe murderers as people being chopped up, Lizzie Borden style. In the case of the Villisca killer, the man from the train, this was a bludgeoning. They had their heads stoved in with the axe. This is the feel-good part of the presentation. It'll get less axe murdery as we go along, I promise. So the owners of the house today have done a very, very good job of recreating the feel of that era. And they still keep every glass surface covered, every reflective surface covered, just as it was on that night. This is me in the attic. These are nails. The reason I'm crouching is not to look dramatic or anything. These are nails and studs that if somebody my height were to stand up, there would be another victim in the Villisca house, you know. And you can see it has those kind of, I have to say, very Amityville horror looking windows, which were so much in vogue with this type of construction. This is where, again, a lot of historians believe the killer hid, broke into the house while the family was at church and waited for night to fall. Now, Johnny Hauser is the caretaker of this place. He's a lovely guy. If you watch the ghost shows, you might know him. He's a big, bearded, muscular, tattooed dude, looks like a biker, and then talks to you. He's very soft-spoken. He sounds like your bank manager. And he's had some incredible experiences in this place. And I asked him what one of the strangest was, and he said, well, I was up in the attic one day, just cleaning up, and heard footsteps on the staircase. Now, because people do every so often come by and try and walk into the house, he carried a gun. And he pulled out his gun, he heard these big heavy footsteps walking up the staircase, boom, 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 boom. This wasn't a child, this probably wasn't a female, unless it was a heavy one wearing hobnail boots. And as the footsteps came along the hallway outside, Johnny pulled the gun and said, "Whoever you are, I'm armed, and if you take another step in my direction, I'm going to shoot." And of course, the steps continue right into the doorway, nobody there. So the house has a reputation for being extremely haunted, and I'm 100% convinced that it is after spending some time there. You can see a better view of the barn there, which is maybe where the killer hid. This is the kitchen. Just to give you a sense of it. Looks bright and cheerful if you didn't know what happened in the house. Things change after dark in places like Villisca. Here is the living room. You can see that you've got your heating there, your furnace, the piano, wooden chairs, everything like that. Again, looks quite nice. Walk into the back bedroom, still downstairs. This is where the two visiting girls, the Stillinger girls, were asleep in bed and were murdered. It's believed that one of them may have woken and fought back because of some defensive wounds that the coroner found on her body. But yeah, these are the two beds, not the actual ones, but locations where the two visiting girls were killed. If the killer came in from the barn, he probably killed them first, then went up this staircase, the creakiest staircase in North America. And there's a view from the top of the staircase down, just to give you a sense of perspective. And into the room occupied by J.B. Moore and his wife, Sarah, 43 and 39. Again, not the original bed, but the bed is in the location where it would have been. And probably one of the most disturbing things is that if you were to pay close attention to the ceiling, until very recently, they've now covered them up. You could see the marks where the axe from the backswing gouged chunks out of the ceiling in the bedroom. So they were hit with great force. And then the killer went on to the children's bedroom. So this is where the remaining four children would be sleeping, two to a bed. There's one in the crib. And then they would kill. And it's, you can again see that the mirror is still covered. Visitors from around the world leave toys for children to come play with, which I think is a very nice gesture. And then it starts to get dark. And you know, one thing about skepticism, I consider myself skeptical. You know, I hear some pretty crazy stories, and I've lived some pretty crazy experiences. And it's one thing to be skeptical when you're in a place like this at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and it looks like that. When it starts to get dark, your own mind starts to play tricks on you a little bit. Psychologically, you know, because you have already prejudiced yourself, you know what happened in this place. You can imagine every creaking floorboard, if you're not careful, starts to sound like a footstep. So you really do have to be on your guard against your own senses and your own psychological preconditioning. We read the place out. I'm not by any means a psychic or a medium. I do have friends that have that ability or claim to, and most of them say that if you're going to get spirit activity, then you want to do it with red light. Darkness works well, but who knows what's going on if it's dark, unless we're using our infrared thermal cameras. A red light works really well. We placed red flashlights around, and one of them, which we had here in a candle sconce on the wall, was switching itself off and on demand. Incredible thing to see. We would ask for it to be turned on, it was. We would ask for it to be switched off, it was. We changed out the batteries, thinking maybe the batteries are starting to go, although the timing would have been so coincidental. And we also start each investigation out with factory fresh batteries. And this thing would be going on and off as we asked for it. Now, this is an LED flashlight. There is an old technique called the maglite trick, where if you have a maglite, you might have seen this done on some of the ghost shows. If you unscrew it just enough that there's barely electrical contact being made, this thing will turn off and on and off and on. And people will tell you it's paranormal activity. Maybe. But anybody who has an engineering background knows that when those devices start to get warm, what happens to metal when it gets warm? Expansion, which makes a stronger contact. Flashlight comes on. You get a little bit of cooling and contraction. It goes off again. So the flashlight trick, as it's called, is very easily debunked in a lot of cases. If you use an LED flashlight, we're talking electrical circuitry, that's not as easy to explain. And that's why we were using LEDs in this case. Okay. They say the camera adds 10 pounds. They had 6 on me at this point. Or so I'm telling people. So what you're seeing here is the doorway from the living room, and then I'm standing in the kitchen, and here is the staircase leading up to the bedrooms. I'm going to skip past that because that's audio. I do want to tell you what these audio files are. We decided to watch a couple of friends called Brad and Barry Kling. They had a show called Ghost Lab, if you ever saw it. It was probably the best paranormal reality show out there. And they investigated the Villisca house, and I wanted to watch their show in the house. I'm like, talk about atmospheric, you know? So I downloaded it to my iPad, and we were watching it, and I accidentally started the video too early. And on my audio recorder, I said, oh, let me stop that, and I stopped it. And then you would hear the giggling of what sounds like a child and me having made a mistake. It was the most amazing thing. We recorded the sound of a child giggling. We got a visit from Johnny Hauser, who lives next door. He came over just to tell us about some of his experiences. He walked in the door, had been in the house 30 seconds, and we hear this colossal boom. And my first thought was something very expensive just fell over. So we go around the house looking to see what it was. Absolutely nothing. This boom, and again, we have it recorded, shook the house. Nothing had fallen. Almost everything in there is breakable. Almost all of our equipment is breakable. Nothing out of place at all. Not remotely unusual for a place like the Villisca Axe Murder House. Just a nice daytime shot from the outside. So, what else did we get in this house? We spent the night there. We recorded several voices. One appeared to be a man's voice. No female voices that we recorded. I've talked to a few people that have investigated this place now, and we're all curious as to what or who haunts this location. It would seem obvious to think that if people were murdered in the house, it would be them. But that doesn't necessarily follow. There has been a great deal of activity in this location that is negative in nature, that is dark, for want of a better word. And I'll give you an example. 4 years ago, a visiting paranormal investigator stabbed himself in the chest in this house. To the point that it was serious enough that when the paramedics arrived, they life-flighted this guy to a hospital. The guy was very, very agitated and couldn't explain why he'd done what he'd done. So strange things like this do happen every so often. You can see Johnny's house in the background there. He refuses to investigate the Axe Murder House anymore because the events there started following him home. He and his wife, who is an absolute skeptic, doesn't believe in this kind of stuff at all, finally said enough is enough when they were starting to experience terrible nightmares and phenomena in their own home. And he went back into the Axe Murder House and said, you know what? I'm sorry, I'm done. I'm done poking into your affairs. Please leave us alone. And to this day, that seems to have worked for him. So, very, very active house indeed. We did hear footsteps ourselves in the house, not just the creaking of floorboards or anything like that. Definitely what sounded like heavy footsteps on the floor upstairs. Now, that doesn't mean that the spirit of a dead person is wandering around. There is a type of phenomena that's essentially residual. They are recording this presentation right now. So when it's played back, somebody's watching this on their laptop. Obviously, it's not the voice of a dead English guy speaking through the speaker, right? It's a recording. And we believe there is a type of paranormal recording mechanism in nature, an aspect of nature we don't understand yet, which can capture sounds and images and smells, sometimes perhaps emotions, and then if you are in the right place at the right time with the right factors, they can somehow be replayed. Which explains how we have so many accounts of historic buildings, 5 people walking around, one of them sees an apparition, 4 of them don't. One of them smells or hears something odd, the rest of them don't. And we don't know why some people seem to be more capable of experiencing phenomena than others, but they indeed do seem to be. So I don't personally believe that this family haunts the Ballista Axe murder house. I know that Johnny Hauser and a number of other people whose opinions I respect think it's the killer, who did not die in the house, but seems to have been somehow drawn back there. And I do encourage you to watch the episode of Ghost Lab, which was shot at the Axe murder house. You can see it on Amazon right now. Brad and Barry Kling recorded some extraordinary evidence. They placed EMF sensors around the house. Now, you have no power in this house at all. You don't even have a working toilet. You go in the barn, in case anybody's wondering. And so you don't have any electrical sources in there. You bring your own batteries with you. You should not be getting electromagnetic spikes. They recorded upstairs a series of very powerful electromagnetic energy spikes in sequence, moving from bed to bed to bed, as though somebody were moving, standing still, moving on, standing still. Their theory was that this somehow captured the path of the killer as he went from bed to bed. It's quite the theory. So ladies and gentlemen, that is the Villisca Axe Murder House. I do recommend it if you're ever in Iowa and you can't find an Airbnb. The atmosphere is quite unlike anything I've ever experienced before. Are there any questions about this case before I move to the next one? Sir?
You said something about axe marks in the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Why would anyone want to cover those up after all those years?
So I think it's disturbed enough people because being in
that
one. Well, yeah. Not really. I mean, being in that location, it does definitely have an atmosphere, and you think it's so terrible that this many people died here, right? The original axe that was used for the murders was, for the longest time, kept in the local town museum, not anywhere near the house. But I think the owners feel that it's too graphic a reminder of what happened there, if that makes any sense. Ma'am. I don't have an opinion either way,
okay. Because
I don't think there's enough evidence to say either way. If you ask me what my gut instinct was, I'd say I really try not to think with my gut. But knowing the stairs, how creaky the stairs are in this house, if you came in from the downstairs and then climbed those stairs, it would be very hard not to wake the people up that were upstairs. And they were all fast asleep. The way that they were found, they were fast asleep when they were murdered, with the exception of the one girl downstairs. So if I had to bet money, I would probably go with the attic theory. But I can't give you a compelling either way. Ma'am.
What happens to the axe? And does law enforcement have any clues to start to follow?
They did. This was the... I want to say it was mismanaged, but that's not fair. Because if you understand law enforcement back in 1912, the organized police forces that we have today, the detectives and so on and so forth, didn't exist outside of major cities. So the local town sheriff, essentially they had the equivalent of a watchman and deputies, they had no idea how to investigate this place. They called out the National Guard to secure the scene. They brought in bloodhounds, all that kind of stuff. At that point, tourists, essentially, people that were nosy had wandered through the house. Bits of skull were taken as souvenirs. Very, very grisly indeed. So, in terms of a crime scene, it was almost useless by the time you had detectives from the Pinkerton Agency and places like that coming in to investigate. The scene was so contaminated. In terms of suspects, it took a while before they realized that there could be this homicidal maniac responsible. Everybody in Villisca thought it was a local. In fact, for months afterwards, here's the tragedy really, beyond this, fathers would sit up at night, you would have families, neighbors get together in the same house, and the man of the house, remember, 1912, would sit up with a loaded shotgun all night while everybody else slept. And this happened for months. Villisca never really recovered from this. And it's unreasonable to expect them to have solved this crime, quite honestly. When they did get into multiple suspects, a local guy was accused. It turned out that somebody was trying to get the reward money because money became involved, you know. Money came from the families sometimes, or friends of the families, or from the county or the clerk and people like that. When you dangle money in front of people, it's amazing who comes out of the woodwork and starts remembering things, like that mysterious stranger that was seen at midnight walking by the house. So just look at the testimony of the witnesses, and it's one big puzzle that has been over 100 years. People have picked this apart for hundreds of years. They've gone over the house inch by inch. Nobody is sure, and I don't think we ever will be. Ma'am?
You know, you were saying that there was the entity that was going from spot to spot.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't it also have been, rather than the murderer, it could have been the mother putting the children to bed?
That's actually an equally good idea.
Because you said it stopped.
And I'd never considered that.
Two babies in the bed, you have to spend a little bit more time, you know, tucking them and comforting. So
I'd never considered that.
It could have been just her residue because she feels she let her kids down.
Huh.
You know, she now goes and checks on them all the time.
That's an interesting theory. What was that?
Oh, can you repeat the observation?
Yeah. Do you want to repeat that louder for the guys at the back?
Oh, yeah.
It was a great point.
The entity that they found going from bed to bed could actually be the mother feeling bad because she didn't protect her children through the night, so now she goes and checks on the beds every night. So instead of being the murderer, it could be also the mother because she felt bad.
I kind of like the idea of mom still watching over her kids. I like that a lot more. I'm going to call Brad and Barry. They're going to hate you now.
I know.
It's a great theory. I've never thought of that before. That's fantastic.
Well, it's just like your first picture of the red. When you look at the window that's on this side,
yeah,
it actually looks like somebody might be peeking out the window.
Don't say that. I've got to go back there in June.
I sat here looking at that picture for a while.
Let's take a look. And I'll say before we go back, you should always be very wary of a phenomenon called pareidolia. I don't know if you've heard of it, but your brain is wired primarily as a survival mechanism to want to see the human face or human body in random patterns. The big example is the man in the moon. We've all seen it, right? Once you see it, you can't unsee it. So I'm very, very, very wary of ghost pictures that occur in windows because it's a reflective surface.
Right, but it's the curtain, the way the curtain is.
Let's take a look. Is it the very first picture? Like the historical one?
The very first one.
All right.
Yeah.
Anyone have motion sick? This one?
Right there. The curve, the way it's at a triangle like that, it's behind some. So it looks like somebody's peeking from.
Am I getting nearer?
That one.
That one.
That right there.
Right there.
You
yeah.
Right there?
The bottom.
Bottom.
There?
Yeah. The way the curtain is pulled back a little bit.
Maybe. I'm always very, very skeptical again of reflections. And that's the thing. Your eye wants to look at this and your brain wants to see a familiar mm-hmm. form. The brain doesn't like chaos. Not saying you're wrong.
Right. No, I'm just saying when I sat here looking at that picture out of all the windows, that one I could see where somebody would be peeking out the window.
Sure.
Not necessarily looking at it right now, but
and this is the children's bedroom. So that's me not sleeping tonight, thank you.
Sorry.
Ma'am, don't be sorry, I think that's great.
I have a question. Why would they keep the house up and, you know, for 100 years? Is it like a tourist stop?
It is.
I mean, it's so gruesome.
It is a tourist attraction. So the lady asked, if you can't hear at the back, why did they keep the house up all this time? Why not demolish it? And if you ask the question about this house, wait till we get to our next case. And the answer is, I think that, this sounds so horrible. I like Villisca, very friendly people, right? Iowans, by my experience, are lovely people. I made some great friends there. This town is on the way to nowhere. It's small town USA. As a kid growing up in England, I saw all these movies that took place in small town USA, you know, like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. This is that kind of town. Villisca, other than this, is a farming town that really doesn't have another claim to fame. So part of me thinks, I hate to say it, it's one of those things that puts Villisca on the map. I also do think that there's hope that the secret may still be in here. Like there may be some part of the architecture or some part of the events going on that might unlock the mystery of who committed the murders. again, it's just a theory, it's just speculation. There was a question over here. Ma'am?
Was there evidence of anything having been taken, like a souvenir?
No.
Or anything taken?
There was no evidence of anything being stolen. In fact, the killer cooked himself food, ate bacon before leaving their house. Left in a very leisurely way. And we think went back on the train. If you look at all of these axe murders that occurred in this small block of time, all of the houses were very close to the railroad tracks. All of the houses were, how can I put it best? They weren't isolated places. They were all in neighborhoods. So they all fit this very similar pattern, you know? And the killer reacted very similarly in all of them. Always would stage one of the female victims as well, pose them in a certain way. I won't talk too much about it because we would all like to sleep tonight, you know, but if you do read into the Villisca murders, I recommend doing it maybe in the daytime. The commonalities between this and the murders in Colorado Springs and stuff like that almost leaves you in no doubt that this was a killer that was working to a very specific pattern. Any more questions, you lovely people? I'm liking this crowd. All right, let's do another one, shall we?
Will you be talking about your own experiences too?
Absolutely. I talked a little bit about what happened in the house. So before I move on real quick, we moved in. We got there the middle of the day, straight down into the cellar, which it's just a cellar. The scariest thing down there has 8 legs. You know, and then they do tours there in the daytime. You can stop by and walk around and stuff. We had the hot place to ourselves for the night, so we took over at 4 p.m., got the keys, and we went right through till dawn the next day. And there is a lot of waiting around when you visit a haunted location. Despite what you may have seen on TV, there's no way to edit real life, unfortunately. So 90% of what we do is working to find the other 10%, you know? And in this particular case, we did a lot of experiments. We did a lot of sitting around, and as for what happened to us, recording those voices, we know there were no children there, we know there was no male there that spoke in the way that we recorded, were probably my favorite experiences, the footsteps that we heard coming from upstairs, and I think for me, the icing on the cake was that flashlight switching itself on and off when we asked for it, an LED flashlight. The rest of it, I drank more energy drinks than were good for me. My wife's trying to stop me from doing that, so I'll probably be in trouble for that when I get home. And we did a lot of sitting around. So I'd love to tell you that it's all objects flying off shelves and stuff like that. That isn't really the way paranormal research works, certainly not if you're doing it honestly and reputably. 90% of it is waiting for that other 10% to happen. And on that note, okay, let me introduce you to this lovely chap. He does look like a bank manager. Not that I have anything against bank managers. His name's Herbert. Herbert Baumeister. Have any of you heard of this fellow? What circles do you ladies move in? He was a family man. In fact, there's Herbert and his family. Not the greatest resolution picture. But he's a family man, you can see. Spouse, children. So, if you're married and you have a spouse, when they go out for the day or for the weekend, you get to do stuff that you wouldn't do when they were at home. Right? When my wife's out, I watch, I don't know that I should admit this in public, I just go for it. I watch a show called Ghost Adventures. That's my guilty pleasure. Because I can, and she doesn't like that kind of stuff. Herb, slightly differently to me. When Herb's wife and kids were away at the lake, I mean, look, we all have our thing, right? We all have our hobbies. Herb was going to gay bars in Indianapolis and murdering men. So on the surface, he's this pillar of the community. Family man, you know, upstanding. He runs some thrift stores. Save-A-Lot was the name. He runs a series of thrift stores and owns this gorgeous house called Box Hollow Farm. And I'd like to take you behind there and tell you the story for our next case. His wife has no idea, though, that, again, while she's gone, Herb will assume the name Brian Smart, and he will go out into the town, onto the gay scene in Indianapolis, and he would pick up younger men. Now, this is in the mid-1990s. Prior to that, bodies turned up along the highway between Indianapolis and Ohio. Always young men. Usually partially clothed. Bodies always abandoned near a road, as though somebody had picked them up on the road, had done something, and then had abandoned them on the road. In fact, this killer gained the name the I-70 Strangler. So Herb's MO, he goes to these kind of bars. His name is Brian Smart, or so he tells people. He dresses well, he's got money, he's friendly. People that know him actually call him Weird Herb in a nice way. They would say, Herb, lovely guy, give you the shirt off his back, bit weird. That was how the neighbors would describe him. So what he would tell these young men was that he was a contractor, and he's working on this mansion house, and he's all alone there for the weekend and wants some company. Someone to come back and party with him. And the best thing of all is, there's a pool in the basement. Now, I've yet to see a house with a pool in the basement. So let's go back to the pool and party. We can have a few drinks, because there's also a bar down there. And see what happens, you know? Well, he did not have a shortage of volunteers. And one thing I'd like to say is that the gay community back in the early to mid-90s, in most cities, the police weren't all that interested if they started to go missing. There was a real stigma to it. So young men were disappearing throughout the Indianapolis area. When people remarked upon it, some said, well, perhaps they got AIDS and died. Others said they just moved on to another town. But one thing's for sure, when these men disappeared, they were never seen again by family or friends. Now, Herb was smart, like his namesake, in that he tried to pick vulnerable young men that wouldn't be missed. He went for those that their families had perhaps disowned them or were ashamed of them. People that weren't living with someone who would miss them. He targeted them, just like a predator would. And this is the 501 Tavern, again, not a great resolution. The sign is still there today. The building has long since been closed down. Fox Hollow Farm. This only ever comes to the attention of the authorities when he tries to pick up a man by the name of Tony Harris. That's not his real name. I met Tony and interviewed him at length, extensively at Fox Hollow Farm, but he goes by the name of Tony Harris. Tony Harris goes back to the house with Herb one night, one dark night, gets into the pool, and you know what? I'm just going to hold that thought while I show you the pool, so you can see how this all played out. Why? But the important thing to know is that when Tony Harris escaped, he's the one victim we know of that got away from the I-70 Strangler. All he could tell the authorities was that he was at a place that was something farm in the middle of rural Indiana. Not a lot to go on back then. Now we just punch that into Apple Maps, right? The case would be solved in a while. Back then, believe it or not, you would have to drive miles and miles of backcountry roads to find this place. That sign has always been there. And it's there to this day. It's original. Here's the house itself. Isn't it gorgeous? It's a Tudor style, looks very much like the kind of things I would see at home in my native England. Lovely. This is the back lawn. So you're standing in front of the woods. This is the back of the house, just to give you some perspective. If you were to walk all the way through, these three sets of sliding glass patio doors take you to an indoor swimming pool. This is the house from the air, 18 acres. It's massive. And again, sorry for the poor resolution. This is where the sign is I just showed you, the driveway to the house. You've also got this big multi-car garage and a stable block, and then woods all around. So huge. You could easily get lost in this place. That's a better resolution shot of the house itself. You can see the garage there, you can see the woods, the stable block, and all the woods. It was a very sobering thought when I took a team to Fox Hollow the first time in 2016, that at least 11 men, more likely 17 to 20, walked down these steps and never came back up. These are the steps that lead down from the main floor of the house, from the kitchen, down to the basement. And if you were to turn right, this is the swimming pool. And here's the pool.
Oh.
Looks perfectly ordinary, right?
Mm-hmm.
I would quite like to have this in my basement. So, here's the scene. Back then, if you see the police crime scene photographs, there were mannequins, you know, shop front mannequins, staged around this place, dressed in colorful clothes, as if there's a party going on. They have wine glasses, they're wearing Hawaiian shirts and things like that. There's a bar directly behind us. We're standing at the shallow end of the pool. Directly behind is a bar, and I'll show you that in a moment, okay? And then here is the pump room for the pool. Herb would, before he went out, crank up the heat on this pool to maximum. He would roll the pool cover across so the pool's completely covered, and then he would go out onto the town. So this thing's basically cooking for hours. It's like a sauna. And then when he comes back with a young man, he would bring the cover back across, uncover the pool. Now this is basically not quite boiling, but you know, very, very hot indeed. Turn out the lights, and then he would open the three glass doors leading outside. That cool night air rushes in, and you get steam instantly. You can't see a thing in this pool. Get the young men into the pool, and he would say, hey, have a drink, you know, have a little something to loosen you up a bit. He'd say, hey, I've got a cool trick. And he would take a pool hose, and he'd say, if you loop that around your neck, or if you let me do this, it can cause the most intense experience imaginable. I shouldn't need to be any more overt in a library, should I, guys? Right? I'm not going to paint the picture any more than that. So, Herb would suffocate these men. He would slowly asphyxiate them to bring them pleasure, but he kept tightening the hose until they died. This is the bar that is directly behind. So the swimming pool now is in this area. We don't know exactly what happened once the young men were dead. Some of them almost certainly died in this area too. The pool table's fairly new. We do have it from Tony Harris, the one survivor, that a video camera, one of those big old VHS cameras, was set up in the corner of the room to record events. But whatever he did, once they were dead, he would take the bodies out into the woods behind the house, and he would just leave them there. Then he would go back out when he felt the need to. He would burn them, pour gasoline over them, set fire to them. He would take tools to them to try and smash them up, essentially make them unrecognizable. So he had a burn pile where he burned one set of human remains, and the rest he just left to rot, to decompose, which is the worst thing he could have done, according to the police officers. The reason he got caught was his son, his young boy, is out in the woods one day behind the farm. He finds a human skull. Now, what does a young lad do if he finds a human skull in the woods? He goes to scare the pants off his sister. She's got a bedroom window upstairs, takes a huge stick, puts the skull on it. Hilarity ensues, right? Pandemonium. Mom comes out, what's going on? Where did you get that skull? Out in the woods. Show me. She goes out there and sees there is not just a skull, but there are lots of bones, and they all appear to be human-sized. Well, the game's up for her. The police are called in. There are warrants, there are attorneys, all those kind of things. Herb does the smart thing. He runs for the border and makes it. He goes to Canada. Okay? Is caught, believe it or not, is caught by a Mountie sleeping in his car under a bridge. Right? Not arrested because they didn't know who he was. And what's fascinating is, this officer said afterwards, there was a box of VHS tapes on the back seat of his car. Nobody knows where they went, but we all know what was probably on those tapes. They're gone. They disappeared. Never found. He drives to a beach, a very lonely beach, goes onto the sand, he eats his favorite food, which I believe is a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. He writes his suicide note. which talks about his failing business and how his family are disappointed in him. Nothing about murder at all. No admission of guilt. Signs it the Herb Baumeister. Then takes his dad's gun, which he called Dirty Harry, was a magnum, and shot himself in the head. Escaped justice. Now, believe it or not, the police have said, well, he was the only ever suspect, he was never convicted. He might actually have gotten away with the murders if he'd lived. He didn't bury the bodies. So if you think about what critters do, foxes, raccoons, those kind of animals, they scattered those bones far and wide. When the police turned up to investigate Fox Hollow Farm, they had a warrant, they went out into the woods, and they found thousands of bones and bone fragments. The number 5,500 is the last one that I heard. And get this, it's the last day, it's the Friday, the last day of the search, they found thousands of bones. Two neighborhood kids come by on bikes, and they say, what are you doing, mister? And the doc that is involved leading the search says, we're looking for bones. The kids say, oh, bones. We know where there's a load of those. You should go look in the creek just at the edge of the property line. They're getting packed up to go home at this point, call it good. They go out there and they see that the creek has just this landslide of bones, which animals had just taken and ran with. Problem is, there was no way they could prove that he was responsible. He would actually have gone to court and played the defense of, sure, that's my dog. Sure, those are bones. I don't know how they got there. He would probably have gotten away with it if he pushed for a speedy trial. As it was, he evaded justice. He died. And there the story should end. My friends Rob and Vicky Graves bought this house. They got a house that's 18 acres. It's gorgeous, right? They realized as they were taking a look around that they'd seen the house on the news. They had a reputation as that house. And they said to each other, are we really okay living here with what happened? And they decided that, yeah, they were. They were okay living there. So, unsurprisingly, when they moved in, they realized the house has come with a few additional extras. This is the sun setting over one of the body disposal sites in the woods. We spent quite a few nights out in those woods. Vicky realizes as she's vacuuming one morning, the electrical cord for a vacuum cleaner is yanked out of its socket, pulled. That's not good because she was vacuuming down in the pool. She's coming home from work one day, and Vicky's a scientist by profession, didn't believe in ghosts until this house. She comes home one day, she's talking to Rob, her husband, looks off into the woods, right here, exactly here, and sees a young man in a red t-shirt. That's what she knows, bright red t-shirt. Now, they do get ghoulish people dropping by, you know, unannounced to visit the murder place. So they're getting ready to throw this trespasser off, and that's when Vicky realizes, hang on though, he doesn't actually have anything from the waist down, no legs. So the figure was walking but had no visible legs and just disappeared right in front of her eyes. One of Rob's colleagues, a guy called Joe, needs a place to live, so he comes and moves in, rents a room from them in what was the old in-law quarters at the side of the house. Now Joe is about the same age as many of the victims were. One night, he's walking his dog out along that long driveway. The dog starts going crazy, runs off into the woods. Joe goes after it and sees a young man in a bright red shirt, just like Vicky. Didn't notice the legs, but the young man disappeared right in front of his eyes. So now they're both describing the same thing, the same phenomenon. They're watching TV one night, and they have some VHS tapes of news segments that involve the murders. Joe and Vicky realize that the man they saw had the same face, the same features as one of the murder victims. They're absolutely convinced it's the same man. Things really get bad when Joe and one of his buddies and the Graves, they have teenage boys, they're all swimming in the pool one day, having a good old time of it, when all of a sudden Joe feels hands around his neck. He's in the deep end of the pool, just resting on the side. He thinks it's his buddy messing around, one of the boys. Turns around, nobody there. Awkward. Starts to swim back towards the shallow end. All of a sudden, he's pulled under the water. He feels hands grab him and pull him under the water, as if they're trying to drown him. So Joe comes flying to the surface like a Polaris missile. And so everybody out of the pool. I imagine it being like that scene from Jaws. Everybody out of the pool. There was nobody within touching distance of him. Three witnesses saw this, saw him just go under as though he was dragged down. Joe lives, like I said, in these in-law quarters. Late at night, he's starting to hear this knocking on his door. Now, this is Fox Hollow at night. Again, really does look different, doesn't it? And this is a view from that body disposal site towards the back of the house. This is the path that Baumeister would have come when he was disposing of the bodies. This is the inside of those quarters, those in-law quarters. So this is where Joe lived. He wakes up one night, bedroom is right there through this door, and sees a young man running through his apartment, terrified as though he's fleeing for his life. And then the young man disappears just like that. And then there's this terrific hammering on the door, which happened over and over again, always at the same time of the morning. Now this is the outside of the in-law quarters. This is the door which would always get hammered on. Always at 1:45 in the morning, always. And it still happens to Rob's son, who now lives in these quarters, to this day. We spent a night in those quarters. And, oh yeah, so this is the knocker that was hammered on. Herb's books are still there. Like, when he left, a lot of what came with the house was his library and his personal effects. His bathtub is still there. In fact, his bathroom is one of the most haunted parts of the house. Vicky Graves will not go in Rob's, once Herb's, bathroom to this day. She says she doesn't feel welcome there. She feels as though somebody wants her out. And that's also the way that Rob feels. Rob Graves feels that Herb Baumeister is still resident at Fox Hollow Farm. This is his handwriting. So his own personal notes are all over that place as well. A genuinely creepy feeling to be in this place. We moved in for a week. This is the same pool hose that was used to commit the murders. It's still there. This is the pump room. And probably one of the most frightening stories I heard. So the pump room is used to store all the stuff for the pool. It's just off the main pool. Rob brings a friend of his over from work one day and got a little girl, maybe 6-7 years old, right? They're in the pool just talking, as you do, and she says, "Daddy, shh, shh. The young men are trying to sleep in there." Guy grabs his daughter, off they go. I investigated in there with my team. We had some incredible phenomena in there. We took Joe in with us and basically shut ourselves in. We rig up cameras, all that kind of stuff. We have Joe calling out her Baumeister. I kid you not, not only is our equipment going crazy, electromagnetic energy spikes all over the place. I'm standing there, and I will never forget this, I feel fingers stroking me just like that.
Did you break down the
door? I look to my right, because I think it's one of my friends messing around. Now, we have a great sense of humor, but we do not prank each other on investigations. It's our one no-no, because once you start, nobody believes anybody or anything. Right? I would fire anybody that did that. And the next investigator is a good couple of feet away from me, did not do it. Female investigator in there, female's not popular, gets jabbed in the back just below the line of her bra. So, pump room very, very active indeed. Excuse me. Me in the woods. And I hope that conveys just how cold the pool was. I went there in November, and I've got about 5 minutes left, guys, so I'll wrap this up and take questions. I go in November, which is silly. Rob stops heating the pool. It costs him $1,000 a month to heat the pool, and he said, "You're very welcome here, but not $1,000 welcome." So I went in. This is the coldest I've ever been in my entire life. But we record the sound of a growl, and it's not a human growl. This is almost as if there is an animal in there, like a big cat. We record the sound of a growl in the pool. I'm using a digital voice recorder, just talking away. Play back the recording, and you hear a man's voice say the word, "Laura." And it's whispered, you know, "Laura." Laura's my wife's name. She wasn't with us at the time, but what a specific word to crop up. And obviously nobody in the pool decides to start randomly whispering my wife's name into speakers. Makes no sense at all. This is probably my favorite shot, and it's also one of the most disturbing. Although we don't have the heat on, so this is me in the pool, it's kind of nice because you can't see how fat I am in the dark. But you can see that these are those three windows. You can see how this must have looked for so many of those poor souls on the last night of their lives when they were in the same position I was. Going to Fox Hollow was disturbing, and it kind of broke my heart as well. It breaks my heart to think that some of those men possibly may be there to this day. But whatever's growling in that pool is not them. So we brought in a psychic medium. He insists that there is something negative there that was drawn there because of the murders. Something that's not related to the crimes itself, but something that saw that negative energy as a free power source, if you will, as some kind of spiritual banquet. And that, we think, is what growls in the pool. So we just got back from Fox Hollow a few months ago. I was researching it for a book project. I don't think I'll go back again. But you almost want to shower when you leave the place, and it's nothing to do with this, just knowing what happened there. And then there's a one last caveat to the story, one last end to the story. I was investigating a prison a few months ago, and a friend of ours who's a psychic said, end of the night, she said, Richard, I really didn't know how to tell you this. And I've known this lady for 10 years or so. She was at my wedding, you know. She can tell me pretty much anything. She said, being a psychic, it's tough, but there's a man with you. And I'm like, okay. When you say man, she said, well, I think he came back with you from Indiana. And I'm like, oh, okay. Can you describe him? Now, if this were a Hollywood movie, which it ain't, how perfect, right? I show her a picture of her Baumeister. Totally ready for her to say, oh yeah, that's the man, come on. It wasn't. So I have a whole bunch of random photographs on my phone. I go through a few of those, and interspersed with those are pictures of the victims of her Baumeister. She pointed out one of the victims said, that's the man. He came back with you, he seems to like you, seems to be drawn to you. And when you guys came in, he took the opportunity to come back with you. We'd done some industrial grade like saging and smudging and protection. Didn't matter at all. So I asked her nicely if she'd send him back, and I haven't had any worries about it since. So Fox Hollow Farm, ladies and gentlemen, it's one of the, I think, most disturbing, fascinating, and tragic places I've ever investigated. Any questions about this or anything before we wrap up? Sir?
You started out by saying they left their bodies on the side of the road, interstate.
Yes.
But yet, then you started mentioning all the bodies that were behind this house.
Mm-hmm.
Did they determine that they were all young men up behind?
Oh, that's a great question. So if you didn't hear, the gentleman asked, I started out talking about bodies on the interstate, and then a whole bunch of different ones behind the house. The reason that they can't prove the bodies on the interstate were him, The cops believe that it was, the FBI believes that it was, because they occurred at a time when he was traveling to and from Ohio to Indianapolis on business. So they correlated with Herb Baumeister's business trips out of state. And serial killers are actually relatively rare. So, you know, these were his stomping grounds, and they think he was most probably responsible. They can't prove to this day Herb Baumeister murdered anybody. It's all conjecture. Sir?
Is it your observation that these kinds of psychic experiences almost always correlate with some horrible injustice?
So my experience is that there are generally two reasons why you see a haunting. Something very, very bad happened in a place, you had a lot of negative energy, or something very, very good. You have people that love a place so much. I work at the Stanley Hotel, do tours up there, ghost tours. No negative history there at all. Thank you, Mr. King. Right, really happy place. People get married, people come on honeymoon, vacation. Place is very, very haunted. Why? I think you've got all that positive energy, and I think in both cases, something remains behind. And it's either a pleasant something or an unpleasant something. But I think it all comes down to energy, which everything does in the end, doesn't it? It's a great question, sir. I saw a hand up over here, ma'am.
Is there any way to help these spirits, these people in the past, to let go? And I would think it would be horrible to be dead and yet keep reliving this.
Well, firstly, let's not assume that these are necessarily spirits of anybody. Some of them probably could be. Certainly whatever was growling, I think, was intelligent. But remember I talked about that natural recording. The young man that Joe and Vicky saw in the woods could have been no more alive than he is. Now, he's me, but he's a recording, right? He doesn't think, he's not dead, he's not a spirit. So it's entirely possible that a lot of these sightings and things that people hear and sense are every bit as static as that, a moment in time that was imprinted by very strong emotion. I don't like the thought personally of people that have already suffered so much still suffering. I investigated at Gettysburg and on Pickett's Charge, the bloodiest part of the battlefield. We recorded cannon fire, but no EVPs, none of those disembodied voices, which I was so happy with, because the thought that men that died in 1863 still haven't moved on to whatever comes next, frankly, just appalls me and horrifies me. One more question, then we're going to have to be done, I think. Matt. Denial. Rob Graves, which is the greatest name ever, isn't it? Rob, his name really is Rob Graves. Rob is a coroner's assistant. He does autopsies. When he's not a car dealer. Rob sold Jerry Seinfeld his Porsche or Ferrari, I forget which. I mean, and then he does autopsies on the side, I kid you not. So, you know, they're both very scientific, Rob and Vicky. They've come to believe, but they wouldn't have bought the house if they weren't okay with its history. I personally couldn't live there. You could give me this $10 million house and I'll keep my place in Longmont, thank you very much. It's beautiful, but every time you went out onto the back deck, you would be reminded. They've been able to put up the right mental screens and filters to just filter that out. And if you can't do that, this isn't the place for you to live. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a real pleasure tonight talking to you. Thank you so much. Thank you.